Good morning, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd. And to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, Shabbat Shalom. I hope you're having a blessed and peaceful Sabbath day. Now, this lesson is probably going to be one of my favorites for a while because it has such a powerful understanding behind it. And I hope that it will help at least one person who struggles with letting go and putting their trust in the Father. Therefore, I named this subject matter, Are You a Job or Letting Go? Now, we all know the story of Job. And I know many of you have read Job chapter 1 in its entirety, but how many of you have read it on more than one occasion? See, the amazing thing with scripture is the more you read it, the clearer it becomes, because each time you read it, you get more discernment from the same passages that you've already read. Each verse can have multiple meanings based on when you're reading it and what you're referencing it to. We don't have to interpret it. Now, to the story of Job. I bring up Job because way too many of you, and yes, I emphasize you because it's seriously important that some of you look at yourself in this matter. It's nothing personal, but many of you are Jobs and don't even know it or realize it. Now, the caveat to this lesson is that it only applies to believers. If you are a non-believer of whatever sort, this lesson has no bearing on you except you get to learn how believers are supposed to be living. Granted, this life is available to you anytime you desire to become one of the Father's faithful. And if you choose not, I understand that. Sadly, I understand that. After all, we all have free will to choose what we want. Now, as I was saying, many of you have been blessed with so much in your life and yet are suffering so much pain because of your children, and maybe even your spouse. Now, just for a second, separate your life from your children and your spouse and everything else. If they're the source of that pain and suffering that you're going through, mentally erase the thought of them in your mind and look at your blessed life without them. Now, take into account all you have been blessed with as you move forward from this point on in the story. And what I want you to do is put yourself in Job's shoes as I tell his story. So make it your story and listen carefully. Verse 1. There was a man in the land of Uz called Job, and this man was an upright and just man, one that feared God and eschewed evil. So Job was faithful, just, obedient, and he abstained from evil. Now, my reference note tells me this. For as much as he was a Gentile and not a Jew, and yet is pronounced upright and without hypocrisy, it declareth that among the heathen God hath his. Okay, faithful believers, you are still in the shoes of Job so far, even if you are not a Jew. That's the point. Verse 2. And he has 7 sons and 3 daughters. Now, how many children do you have? 1, 2, 3 or more? Verse 3. His substance also was 7,000 sheep and 3,000 camels and 500 yoke of oxen and 500 she donkeys. And his family was very great, so that this man was the greatest in all the east. So among the Chaldeans and whomever, he had the most. He was the most blessed. Now look at your blessings. Not as the world, but how the Father has blessed you and your household with all your needs. Now, some of you may have an abundance and some of you may have just enough. Jobs, cars, home, bank account, the kids may have computers, PlayStations, nice clothes, etc. And you the same. But your family may be well blessed by many standards of the world and some just sufficiently. So now we move to verse 4. And his sons went and banqueted in their houses, every one his day, and sent and called their 3 sisters to eat and drink with them. Now it's starting to get interesting. Are your children out of control in certain manners? Are they disobedient, disrespectful, mean-tempered, selfish, troublemakers, constantly in trouble, hard-headed, sassy, foul-mouthed, basically doing their own thing as Job's children did, doing whatever they want to do? Now, with all that in mind, let's move on to verse 5. And when the days of their banqueting were gone, Job sent and sanctified them, and rose up early in the morning and offered burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job thought, it may be that my sons have sinned and blasphemed God in their hearts. Thus did Job every day. See, Job commanded them to be sanctified, meaning that they should consider their faults that they had committed and reconcile themselves for the same. So what Job did was to offer for every one of his children an offering of reconciliation unto the Almighty. Job was concerned about his children's sinful behavior so much that he interceded on the behalf of his children. Parents, is this you? Are you constantly interceding in your children's lives, whether they are teenagers or grown on their own, as Job's children? Are you always praying for them to the Father? Are you always telling them to make reconciliation with the Father? Are you shouldering a lot of the effects of their actions in your life because you're trying to prevent their actions from reaching the Most High? Do you really think you can protect them from themselves? Are you being a Job? Proverbs 19:19 says this, a man of much anger shall suffer punishment, and though thou deliver him, yet will his anger come again. Now parents, listen carefully to this reference note about this verse. It says that though for a time he give place to counsel, yet soon after will he give place to his raging affections. Or simply put, sometimes you can talk to your children, give them advice and guidance, but after a while, they will go back to doing the same old mess that they love to do. And you, the rescuer, will end up doing the same thing over and over again. Is this you? Bailing them out, counseling, and rescuing your disobedient children, the child, over and over again from the same old drama and mess. Now, I get why you do it. We all love our children. We want to help. We want the best for them. And we don't want them to be lost, or worse yet, dead. But even so, it is not the will of the Father, which is in heaven, that one of these little ones should perish. Matthew 18:14 tells us this. Listen to how it's expressed in 2 Peter 3:9. It reads, the Lord of that promise is not slack, as some men count slackness, but is patient toward us and would have no man to perish, but all men to come to repentance. See, the Almighty doesn't want any of us to perish, but he has a promise to fill, and he will keep it. He keeps all of his promises. Now, my reference says this, the Lord will surely come because he has promised, and neither sooner or later than he's promised. And the second reference says this, the Almighty does patiently wait till the elect are brought to repentance so that none of them may perish. So until then, we all have opportunity to become one of his elect and get right. He's being patient. Now, pay attention closely to verse 6. Now on that day, when the children of God came and stood before the Lord, Satan came also among them. Now, we definitely have to break this verse down because most people have no idea what it's talking about. They just know what it's saying on the surface. But it's teaching us a few things here. Now, the angels are called the sons of God because what? Because they are willing to do his will. Now, they stood before him, and even Satan was before him. Why? Well, another reference says this. This declares that although Satan may be adversary to the Almighty, yet he is compelled to obey him and do all homage, without whose permissions and appointment he can do nothing. Now, this verse teaches us that Satan has no power over the Father, even us if we're being obedient. Satan has no power over us. Also, it shows us that if the Father commands Satan to do something, he is compelled to do it. Just like our children, when we call them front and center, even when they're guilty of doing something wrong, they come. See, they're being obedient. They're compelled to come. Verse 7, then the Lord said unto Satan, whence comest thou? And Satan answered Lord, saying, from compassing the earth to and fro, and walking in it. Now, the Father asked Satan this question for our purpose because he already knows what Satan has been and had been doing. Satan answered the Father in truth and says, from compassing the earth to and fro, and walking in it. Now, the Father compels Satan to tell us the truth so that we can have the truth from Satan's mouth. See, he already knew. This statement describes the nature of Satan to us and is expressed in 1 Peter 5:8, which reads like this: "Be sober and watch, for the adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour." This is what he was saying in verse 7, compassing the earth to and fro. Satan said it. The Father just put it in Scripture so that we would know. Verse 8, "And the Lord said unto Satan, Hast thou not considered my servant Job, how none is like him in the earth, an upright and just man, one that fears God and escheweth evil, or who is obedient and avoids evil?" This who Job was. Verse 9, "Then Satan answered the Lord and said, Doth Job fear God for not?" Now, he asked the Father, is Job only obedient to him because he has given him blessings, because he has given him much? Verse 10, "Hast thou not made an hedge about him, and about his house, and about all that he hath on every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land." So Satan said, have you put protection around him? Verse 11, Satan tries to call the Father out. He says, "But stretch out thine hand and touch all that he hath, to see if he will not blaspheme thee to thy face." Now, two things in this verse, verse 11. One, Satan tries to tempt the Father to come against Job because he has no power to do it, nor can he come against us if we're upright. The Father must do it, and he does this by allowing. Verse 12, "Then the Lord said unto Satan, Lo, all that he hath is in thine hand. Upon himself shalt thou not stretch out thine hand. So Satan departed from the presence of the Lord." See, the Father gives Satan authority or power over man, not to gratify Satan, but to declare that Satan has no power over man except for which he is given to him. See, if he doesn't give it, Satan can't do it. But now Job's trial comes. Verse 13, "On that day when the sons of his daughters were eating and drinking wine in their eldest brother's house." Question, what were they doing? They were having a good old time doing their own thing. Now, the reference takes us to 9:12 of Ecclesiastes, which reads like this: "For neither doth man know his time, but as the fishes which are taken in the evil net, and as the birds that are caught in the snare, so are the children of men snared in the evil time when it falleth upon them suddenly." Proverbs 29:6 breaks it down even more and reads like this: "In the transgression of an evil man is his snare, but the righteous doth sing and rejoice." So when you're in the midst of sin, you never know when your time is going to come, but know that this is a snare or a trap, simply put. That's all it is. It's a trap by the enemy. Job's children were in the midst of sin. On to verse 14. "There came a messenger unto Job and said, The oxen were plowing and the donkeys feeding in their places. And the Sabians came violently and took them. Yea, they have slain the servants with the edge of the sword, but only I am escaped alone to tell thee." Now listen very carefully to verse 16. "And while he was yet speaking, another came and said, The fire of God is fallen from the heaven and hath burnt up the sheep and the servants and devoured them, but I am only escaped alone to tell thee." Now, this was done by the craft of Satan, or the witchcraft of Satan, or by the power of Satan, to tempt Job more grievously so that he might see that not only men were his enemies, but that the Almighty himself has made war against him. Can you say deception? This was a deception by Satan so that Job would blame the Father. Verse 17, "And while he was yet speaking, another came and said, The Chaldeans set out on three bands and fell upon the camels and have taken them and have slain the servants with the edge of the sword. But I only am escaped alone to tell thee." 18, "And while he was yet speaking, came another and said, The sons and the daughters were eating and drinking wine in the eldest brother's house. And behold, there came a great wind from beyond the wilderness and smote the four corners of the house which fell upon the children, and they are dead, and only I am escaped alone to tell thee." Now, this plague declares that when one plague is passed, which seems impossible to bear, the Father can send us another far more grievous than the previous, to try his children and teach them obedience. But we know that this was Satan's doing. Always pay attention to Satan. Verse 20, then Job arose and rent his garment and shaved his head and fell down upon the ground in worship. Now, it's very important to understand this in verse 20. Job's actions were not because of his impatience, but it teaches us that even the father's children are not insensible like blocks, but in their patience, they feel affliction and pain and grief of mind like anyone else, but yet they do not rebel against the father by blaming him as the wicked do. Verse 21 continues on, and said, naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. The Lord hath given, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this did not Job sin, nor charge God foolishly. He said, I came into this world with nothing, and will be put in the ground with nothing, and he still didn't blame the father. Now, the question is this, parents, grandparents, are you being a Job? That's the question. Are you being in Job? Are you prepared to go through a Job-like trial because you are unwilling to let go of disobedience in your life that's not yours? Are you waiting for Satan to call your faithfulness out to the Father so that he may receive permission to bring calamities into your life? Some of you are already suffering them. I say this, why unnecessarily go through this when you can wake up, let transgression have its way with whomever, and let them suffer the repercussions of their own iniquity while you focus on your own salvation? See, you can still be faithful and all that while still set yourself up for attacks from the enemy by allowing him in your life through other people and situations. How many of you have lost husbands, wives, possessions, or whatever because of your children, friends, other family members, or whatever, because you weren't willing to let it out of your life? We are learning something very valuable here. It's a tough lesson, but we need to learn it. How much loss can you bear before breaking under Satan's deceptions and ultimately may end up blaming the father? See, love doesn't mean hanging on. Sometimes it means letting go and loving from a distance. Now, no one loves you more than the father, and in the end, he will have to destroy many of his children, letting go of them because of their sins. So who are we to hang on when the Father will let us go when we refuse him long enough? But God setteth out his love toward us, seeing that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 5:8. Herein was the love of God made manifest among us, because God sent that his only begotten Son into this world that we might live through him. 1 John 4:9. So remember this, the Heavenly Father doesn't call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.